that a member of your team, Walter Sobchak, drew a firearm during league play. If this is true, of course, it contravenes a number of the league's bylaws and also Article 27 of the league.
And it's us. We're back with things and stuff and the internet and all kinds of crazy shit.
We are definitely back. Hello, folks.
Hello. Sorry there's been a bit of a delay, but nobody's been feeling up too much. The news has been kind of universally bad.
It has, hasn't it?
It's been... the only good piece of news is that they've launched another model of Raspberry Pi. That's about it.
Yeah. That's always good, though. I mean, those are amazing.
I love Raspberry Pis. This is how we're going to conquer the world. With computers so cheap you can give them away. Now, what we do need now is a big stash of, like, small SD cards. We need to be able to buy a bulk amount of small SD cards for, like, nothing. And then we can start doing cool shit, like, just giving them away.
Yep.
Wouldn't you love to be able to do that?
Be fantastic.
If you go to an event to just go, right, okay, let's everybody put in, you know, sort of like, I don't know, 30 quid.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like a whole bunch of us. And everybody puts in 30 quid, and we go to a computing event, and we just give away a bunch of Raspberry Pis to children.
Would be amazing.
You have to be under 16 to get one. You know, because that's where you want to be. Here is your computer. Yep. There you go.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with a Ranger's distro on it. And it's like, go check out some shit. Or like an activist thing. A pre-installed Raspberry Pi Zero. Just buy a fuck ton of them.
Oh, yeah. It'd
and
be
then
fucking
put a distro on it that's pre-configured to actually show you how to search for shit. Anyway, so that's the only good news. The new Raspberry Pi Zero's got Wi-Fi and Bluetooth on it. I wish they'd bring out a new Raspberry Pi 3 or Raspberry Pi 4.
Mm-hmm.
More memory, even. Even, we need more RAM. Even,
it
stop fucking about.
Need more
we,
memory,
need,
yeah.
we need a multi-core operating system, and we need more RAM. Because the Orange
yep.
Pi, there's an Orange Pi that's got 8 cores.
Mm-hmm.
Out at the moment with 2 gig of RAM, and it's not actually that more expensive than a Raspberry Pi. That's
oh,
like,
yeah.
I'm okay with a 4-core chip, but I want a multi-core operating system and loads more RAM. I mean, I'd leapfrog the 2 gig and go for 4.
Yep.
Well, I know
it would be nice just have.
We're trying to keep it to the 35 quid, sort of like baseline, but.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
it'd be nice to have that extra RAM on it.
Yeah, just so you can use it as a computer.
Yeah.
Because it's not... It's sort of a computer. You can, like, work... It's like a computer from about 5 or 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to run a modern operating system on the modern internet is a bit of a hassle. So,
it yeah, is a little
more RAM.
Bit, yeah.
In fact, I would be happy if they did the, sort of like, the Raspberry Pi, like an extreme version of Raspberry Pi, and charged a bit more for it.
Yeah. No, I would as well. I'd be quite happy with that. Just a little bit,
yeah.
You know, extra to get the decent hardware on it.
Or a little extra board you can buy on the next
Ooh.
Iteration of Raspberry Pi that just had a fuck ton of RAM on it.
Yeah.
Or a fuck ton of RAM and a small SSD all on the one
all
board.
That. Yeah.
You know, with an interface that bypasses the RAM that's on the motherboard. It just chunks it across to the other thing. They could put 4 gig of RAM and like 16 gig of storage or something. On
That'd
like
be
a,
really
an
cool.
SSD stroke RAM board that just somehow fitted underneath the Pi.
And you, sort of you, like how you got the Arduino shields.
Yeah, so like, you know, like a Raspberry Pi shield that not necessarily using the GPIO because that would be too slow for RAM, but using a different connector.
Yeah.
Like they've got for the camera connector, just on the underside. So you just like chunked it in, and it just overrode the RAM. And sell that for 20 quid because I'd fucking buy that.
It'd be really, really,
it's like
really.
A muscle car add-on for a Raspberry Pi. So you know, mm-hmm. right? Okay, now this is properly replacing a laptop. And then the people that didn't want that on the Raspberry Pi wouldn't have to get it, and it would just be an add-in board, but the option to expand. And then you'd have something. You know, if you could get like 8 gig of RAM. You know, quad or you know, or more cores and like an onboard SSD. You know, to bulk that fucker up. You know, then you'd have a shockproof computer that, you know, that you could use on those little 8 tricks at that docks that would just be awesome. Yeah. Anyway, we digress. But at least we digressed in a Ranger's sort of direction.
Oh, yeah.
Hmm. Anyway, so let's go into the news. Cue the music. The first news story seems frivolous, I warn you now. So Nokia's 3310 phone has been relaunched nearly 17 after its debut. Many consider the original handset iconic because of its popularity and sturdiness. More than 126 million were produced before it was phased out in 2005. The revamped version will be sold under license by the Finnish startup HMD Global, which also unveiled several Nokia-branded Android smartphones. One expert said it was a fantastic way to relaunch Nokia's phone brand. The 3310 was the first mass-market mobile, and there's a massive amount of nostalgia and affection for it, commented Ben Wood from the technology consultancy CCS Insight. If HMD had just announced 3 Android devices, they would have barely got a couple of column inches in the press. So the 3310 is a very clever move, and we expect it to sell in significant volumes. And the announcement was made ahead of the start of Mobile World Congress Tech Show in Barcelona. LG Huawei and Lenovo, among others, to have unveiled new devices. I'm kind of interested in what Lenovo are doing. I think they're an interesting company. Nokia no longer makes phones itself, but manufactures telecoms equipment, Ozo virtual reality cameras, and health kit under the Withings brand. The new 3310 qualifies as a feature phone rather than a smartphone, as it only provides limited internet facility. However, its advantage over more powerful handsets is its battery life. HMD says the color screen phone has up to a month's standby time and delivers more than 22 hours of talk time. It's expected to launch at €49 or £41.51. Okay. And this is the key thing. It's almost like a digital detox or a holiday phone, HMD chief executive Arturo Minella told the BBC. Yeah. All the rest is just them going, oh, how wonderful. Now, the reason this is in there, oh, yes, it takes me back to days of yore, of over 10 years ago. Okay, this is, it's got two things. One, it's the shortening of nostalgia.
Yeah.
You know, it's shortening the time that people can be nostalgic about to basically cash in nostalgia money. He's going for the nostalgia dollar. That's a good dollar. For hipsters and millennials. Yeah, so you see that they're sort of like, you know, oh, it has less features. It's like somebody's gone with the Apple way of doing things, where the reiteration of things like the Apple TV and the Apple sort of Mini were feature stripped over time as the price went up.
Yep.
Which is weird. It goes counter to everything in, you know, design and sales and all that sort of thing. But it's this kind of like, I guarantee you, you'll still be able to get Facebook on it.
Most likely,
which,
yes.
On an original 3310, there's no way in fucking hell you're ever going to get Facebook on it. So it's basically for millennial type people who want to look like they eschew the trappings of modern life. You know, it's a bit like somebody saying they've quit smoking, but they're still vaping heavy nicotine vapors.
Yep.
And this is what this is. This is like a, well, you could quit being so connected and one of the sheeple by having less connectivity. But we can still connect you to all the corporate shit. I bet you can get onto eBay with it, and I bet you can buy stuff from Waitrose using your 3310 dumb phone. Because this isn't a 3310. Because the 3310, the internet didn't exist as we know it now, when it came out.
No, it was WAP, yeah. Back then.
And if anybody's old enough and you remember WAP, WAP was shit. It was really bad. It looked like the internet was coming to your phone, and it was the precursor to it. And I guess WAP had to happen to prove to what a wonderful thing broadband on a smartphone would be. And it is. But think of all the things you can do on a smartphone now.
Yeah.
You know, smartphones, Android is such a simple system that you can create like fuck on a smartphone. You can shoot film. You can video police officers doing brutal shit. You can edit that footage and upload it to the internet all from one device. You can play music on it because they've developed synths and all sorts of things for it. You can connect to the world, basically, and all the media that the world has to offer and contribute back to it. And now, sort of like, I guarantee you, all the other companies are going to come up with dumber phones with longer battery time, and there'll be a sort of weird hipster backlash. And people will de-equip themselves to have something that's hipper.
That wouldn't surprise me.
You know, given that the internet is already way too powerful and people are now using smart TVs instead of computers to get on the internet. You know, this sort of like slowly stripping out power, you know, yeah. And this has been going on for a while. The idea of the end of general purpose computing. You know, the idea that basically people don't want all that faff of actually creating or having a say. They want, you know, they just want to watch stuff. You know, so all these great strides that people made using the internet and all this activism that happened and all these things, you know, people's ability to report on what's happening in the world are all being sort of taken back slowly under the guise of what's cool. How fucked up is that?
Yeah.
In fact, if I see one fucking person brandish a Nokia 3310 at me, I'm going to kick off into full-on sheeple rant.
I was just reading in the thing that it it will have a small range of apps. So
yeah, I bet guaranteed you're everything that generates money.
Yeah, so you guarantee you have Facebook on there. Relies on 2.5G connectivity, which it says which has slower speeds than 3G or 4G. But worth remembering that 2.5G is edge. It's the one of the names for it. And when the iPhone first launched, the iPhone was just Edge.
Oh, here's an interesting thing for you people out there. If you get an original 3G Kindle, it has a switching system on the radio package that will switch to Edge. And Edge works in all sorts of places where you wouldn't expect it to. So if you want to get free, hard-to-trace internet, rush out and see if you can buy an old second-hand 3G keyboard Kindle. Because that comes with free internet forever, but it does use Edge. And you can get Edge at sea.
Well, you've
got a system that switches to Edge. You can get it if you're in inland waters. So you'd be far away from a phone mast, but you can still access the internet.
Yeah.
So that's something worth thinking about. But it's a much more robust radio system. So, run off and get one. You know, don't try not to pay more than 40 quid for one, but if you wanted internet, and it's slow and shitty internet, but it is functional internet, and you've got a device with a keyboard that lasts for months. If you use the Wi-Fi system on a Kindle, it does kill the battery down in about a day. But
yep.
That is an interesting thing. If you wanted to sort of like, you know, disappear from the internet, but still have access, a 3G Wi-Fi Kindle of the earlier generations, I think it was second generation Kindle. That did that. I had one and it was awesome. I've got to get another one. But yeah, this is the sort of like voluntary disarming of the general populace. I mean, not that hipsters really stand for anything apart from spending 50 quid on beard wax.
Yeah.
And artisanal ice cream and shit like that. Artisanal generally means we sort of made it in that we bought in a load of ingredients and mixed them together ourselves, and we're going to give you less and charge you double. Which, if you know me, doing that with ice cream is just plain fucking wrong. But yeah, so this idea is sort of like getting people to voluntary disarm as far as the digital weaponry is concerned, is what's happening here. We'll make it really hip and do it in all sorts of colours so you can express your individuality also while disarming yourself. Because smartphones have got to be the bane of government. You know, it's got to be awful that you've got especially in a country like the UK, where you've got nearly 100% saturation. Everybody that wants a smartphone has one.
Yeah, look at how many times politicians or officials have been caught out by people with smartphones.
Yeah. you know, you basically got a TV studio and a recording studio and access for broadcast all on the one pocket-sized device.
Yeah.
Really, really hard to stop people using.
It's no longer he said, she said anymore.
Yeah.
When it comes to things being said, it's now a case of here's video of said politician saying X.
Yeah.
Means that, you know, they've got to be essentially got to be on all the time, and I can imagine that's a.
I mean, that anti-drugs and prostitution judge that got caught on camera, sort of going, "Oh, did you bring any cocaine?" You know, and saying it would be nice to have some Asian hookers because they look like little girls.
Ooh.
On fucking camera, you know, that was shot with a smartphone, but smartphones are now so good, it's not like. I mean, the thing about a 3310 is that its camera's really shit. It's got like a 2-megapixel camera.
Yep.
That's got to be the best ever fucking news. You know,
just people like that, yeah.
For politicians and stuff. Well, that could be anybody. You know, just like, you know, a terrible microphone. Whereas like the modern smartphone's got an amazing camera and an amazing microphone for
it's
its
like
size.
2 megapixels is a terrible picture quality.
That's 640 by 480.
Yeah, something like that. It's not great.
You know, it's really rubbish. I mean, I suppose the only benefit to having shitty cameras on smartphones is that we'll get some nice new grainy hipster footage of UFOs and Bigfoot. We'll get more Bigfoot and UFO pictures, because I tell you, that's something that's totally disappeared in the last 10 years. When was the last time you saw a current picture of a UFO?
A while ago, not recently.
Yeah,
a long
and
time
that's
ago.
Because every fucker in the universe has got a smartphone.
Yeah.
And now when somebody says, "Oh, I saw a UFO, and here is my grainy, shitty, thick footage of it," and it's like, dude, you've got an Apple iPhone. That should be the most, you know, that should look like, you know, Independence Day.
Exactly.
You know, that should be the best ever footage of any flying saucer ever. So you notice that shit's disappeared. No more pictures of Bigfoot. No more grainy.
Well, yeah,
oh, I just caught it out of the corner of my eye, and this is my shitty smartphone footage. Because I only had my phone on me. And it's like, you had your phone on you, dude. That should be, like, you know, it should be the best footage ever of Bigfoot, or the Loch Ness Monster, or some other shit. And it's all stopped. All that cryptozoology shit has just stopped.
Because they can't pass off the crap anymore.
No, they can't sort of say, well, it's all really grainy because I was really panicked. And it's like, your phone would have taken care of that.
No, yeah.
New smartphones will adjust the light levels if it's dark. They'll, you know, sort of be absolutely awesome. And you should have, you know, if there were such things, there would be more pictures than ever of UFOs. And they would be pin sharp, and we would go, oh, yes, aliens are coming. But where they're not.
Yep. They're not.
Just my personal rant on, you know, on getting people to believe shit that people know isn't true. We'll be coming back to that later.
That's what
I did there.
Yep, nice little tidbit for the layer.
Okay, you'll like this next story.
Yeah, let's go over here. Okay, Wells Fargo says that its customers gave up rights to sue by having their signatures forged.
This is so neat.
Wow. Excuse me. Even though disgraced Wells Fargo CEO John Stumpf has left the building, his most outrageous legal theories live on. On Wednesday, the company filed a motion in federal court in Utah, seeking dismissal of a class action suit by the customers it defrauded. The bank argues that since the customers signed a binding arbitration agreement when they opened new accounts, the customers whose signatures were forged on fraudulent new accounts should be subject to this agreement and denied a day in court.
Now, it does go on quite some way, but essentially, they open new accounts, forging customer signatures, like millions of them. Okay, so these people didn't know they had a second bank account with Wells Fargo. Like, Wells Fargo opened up the second bank account and pretended the customer had. And it's like, you know, hundreds of thousands of these accounts were opened. And in opening the account with this forged signature, they agreed to this binding arbitration agreement, which means that they can't form a class action lawsuit. They have to arbitrate with Wells Fargo, which can take years.
Yep.
Individually. So Wells Fargo, giant bank, against an individual with limited means. And Wells Fargo can keep these people in arbitration for years. Okay. And the only reason they're allowed to do this is because they've got a signed document signed by the customer, but not at all. The signature was forged, saying that they wouldn't form a class action lawsuit against Wells Fargo.
Yep.
So if you can imagine that, say somebody opened a bank account in your name, ran up charges, charged you the money, you went and investigate, and they said, well, essentially it turns out that the person, somebody who managed your bank account, set up a new bank account for you and put you into debit, and we've charged all these charges despite the fact you've never signed anything, but we thought we've got a piece of paper with your forged signature on it that says that you can't do anything about it.
Pretty much. It's scary.
That's just manufacturing, you know, basically manufacturing the ability to steal.
Yeah.
And not,
that is,
and not from a hacker breaking into Wells Fargo, from inside Wells Fargo.
Yeah.
This is that Wells Fargo stole money from you, from your bank account with them, using a second bank account that racked up charges. And oh, by the way, they also created a document that they claim you signed, and you've got to take into court to prove you didn't, to say that they could do this and stop you from going to court. So they made themselves not liable, or liable eventually. But if say they've run up $50 of bank charges for you, you can't afford as an individual to take them to court.
No.
Because this is a civil crime. You know, it's just amazing.
It's incredible. It's like they've done this on purpose, essentially taking... This is why it's so important that the courts do the actual right thing with this, and the what's more important for the people is taken into consideration rather than what's more important for businesses. Because there's a bit here, it says mandating arbitration when selling financial products has become standard practice after a 2011 US Supreme Court decision validating the practice. Had not the US Supreme Court validated that, and I'm not blaming the Supreme Court here, because it could have been any court, and it all depends. It's not the court had different judges, so some probably had a judge on that at that time who was more pally to businesses.
Yeah.
Had that not been the case, then the class action lawsuit wouldn't have been had a problem anymore. You know, they could have done a class action lawsuit. Now they can't.
Hmm.
And it's just... Oh, fucking... It's all designed to...
I'm sure the lawyer that came up with this as a defense and a thing...
Mm-hmm.
You know, couldn't get rid of his erection for like 6 weeks. Because that's just so Kafka-esque.
It really is.
You know, I mean, you know, I think that, you know, the government should have a taking the piss clause inserted into every contract. If you are found to be massively taking the piss, we're gonna asset strip you anyway.
Yeah.
You know, it might be legal. It's a bit like the not proven thing in Scotland. You know, whereas if the judge genuinely believes that you are a nasty scroat and you definitely did do this, and you're likely to go out there and do the same sort of thing again, you get a verdict of not proven, which doesn't mean innocent or guilty. It means that if I find you in my fucking court accused of this again, the same thing, you're going down, buddy.
Yeah.
And you need something along those lines, the taking the piss clause, is if you are taking the piss and say 9 out of 10 judges agree that you are taking the piss, then they are granted some powers to sort that out. Because if you're going to be as open-ended as that, so you can create a document, forge a customer's signature, and bind them legally to that, to the contract that you've just made up for them.
I think this is also probably another interesting point here is the use of signatures as a legal binding of individuality.
Yeah.
A legal representation of an individual. You know, if you can, if they can forge signatures that easily, what does that say about using signatures to
well, test validity? Well, signature obviously isn't a valid form of ID, is it?
No, it's clearly not. It's clearly not a valid form of ID.
I mean, you can still sign a document with an X if that's genuinely what you sign documents with.
Yeah. So, you know, how can anyone say that a signature is a worthy way of saying that, oh yeah, no, you did agree to this? It's not.
But,
it really isn't.
The reason perhaps this news story is in there is kind of because companies are doing this or things like it all over the world right now.
Perhaps we need some form of way that's more... I'm sorry, I'm really bad with words this morning. Perhaps we need some way, maybe electronic, of being a secure 100%. Maybe something like PGP, the way PGP does, like, public keys and private keys, to authenticate people to say, yes, no, I did agree. This is me. I did agree to this.
Mm.
I mean, technically... We're in a paperless society. Everything that we do that has transactions related is electronic. Yeah. The only reason we have paper for things, unless you're a really backwards company who's stuck in the early 20th century, and there are some of those still, everything that you do is electronic.
Mm. That still means it can be forged.
I can think of ways to get around that.
Yeah, I'm kind and of going, why going I say, by the sort of like the sci-fi, you know, the self-destruct on things.
Yeah, well, it's like, you know, with, you know, you can generate like one-time passwords for things.
Mm.
So you have like one-time authentication codes, which are only valid for that particular document, but still relate to you. And you can't reverse it to find out who it belongs to, but when you, I mean, assuming that it'll have your name as well, if they say, can you confirm the validity of this document, you can use your key, your secure key, that you alone have access to prove that you have signed that document with your electronic signature, as it were. And you'd be the only person to be able to prove that. No one can prove that.
See, I'd be tempted to go along something like it puts together your numerical genetic code. Like you give a sort of like a cheek sample. The computer analyzes your genetic code, selects a random number of chromosomes.
Mm-hmm.
So like a 5-digit chromosomal key that changes every single time you do a document.
Yeah. Well, That's pretty good, but the problem I have with that, and there's only just like one problem I have with that, is that it does mean that it's...
You're going to be paranoid about leaving your DNA everywhere.
That, yes. And it's a little bit... How are you going to... getting DNA checked every time you need to confirm something, and I'm not sure how long it takes for DNA checks. Whereas, when we're used to things now, we used to be able to put a card... We've got contactless... paying for things. And, you know, I'm not saying contactless is bad. I use contactless daily. It's so much easier and more secure than putting your PIN into things, because you don't have to worry about people looking at your PIN.
Yeah, somebody has to physically have your card. And if you lose it, even you can cancel it immediately.
Yeah, you can cancel it immediately, but then again, they're limited to how many £30 transactions. And after a certain number of them, it asks you to put your card and enter your PIN anyway, just to check. And by that time, you've probably rung up your bank and said, I lost my thing. Can you cancel it for me? But it's like, what I'm thinking of is maybe something like a card.
Mm.
I mean, this might be saying you need ID cards from now on. But I mean, you know, you've got a national insurance card anyway. You've got to have a national insurance card in this country to have a job. Mm. You know, there will be some form of like identify, whether it's national insurance or something. You know? And this might not appeal to some people because it sounds a lot like. Well, no, it is. This system even requires government infrastructure to look after it, or it requires an accepted, but it requires something like Bitcoin. That's open, worldwide, secure, and accepted, but isn't beholden to any particular group. But then that means it's up to you to look after that security yourself.
Well, kind of like PayPal.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is a really interesting. I just thought it was a really interesting case of sort of like a company creating a document that they claim you've signed, and the document that you've signed. Is kind of says that they can do what they want.
Yeah. I mean,
they're within law, you know, so well, if you have a problem with us, you can take us to arbitration, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
There's this weird loophole.
Now that I'm thinking about it, right? I'm not sure, but I'm pretty sure that when you sign up for a bank account, you do need some form of identification.
You do.
You need, obviously, proof of your address. And I believe you need something to prove who you are. So you either need a birth certificate or you need a driving license or a passport.
Yeah.
Now, if you're going to get something like that, you might as well just make it a citizen's identity card.
Yeah. Which has problems with that, you know, in that if you have a citizen's identification card and everybody has one, you've got an issue where. You know, police could, you know, not when it came out, but years later say that they should have the right to demand that ID card off you whenever they want. And it's a slippery slope. Once, if you create a thing, taking it back and getting rid of it is very, very hard.
That is the main thing that's the problem, which is why I'm a little more in favour of the Bitcoin-style distributed way of it. But... I would say it would require like a lot of people and businesses to get together and say, okay, how can we make this the most secure and protect people? I mean, so long as it works along the way of PGP, it should be okay, you know. I mean, I don't think anyone's actually found a way of getting people's private key without actually, you know, physically getting hold of people's private key.
Yeah. I think,
and that's,
you know,
all you need.
An ethical sub clause in the operating systems of all businesses, where the taking the piss law works much better. It's up to the corporation to prove that you signed that. Not up to you to prove that you didn't. You know.
Well, yeah. I agree with you there. That's really good. You've gone on the more realistic route, and I've gone on the more ideal route.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be nice if governments didn't take advantage of having a catalogue of all their citizens, but you know they would.
Yeah,
and the benefits would be far outweighed by the drawbacks.
Sorry, I meant more that you're thinking that more realistically, a company having a don't take the piss law is more. Fitting, and then when I said I was more idealistic, I mean that having digital signatures instead of written signatures is better. I think both are valid, to be honest. I think digital signatures have to happen at some point and have to replace written signatures, even if this means like, well, I don't know. I mean, I think you could probably, actually just thinking there about what does it mean for living off grid, but I think if you can, if Bitcoin, you know, can exist, which allows people to live off grid and people will accept payments by Bitcoin, then, you know, why can't you have, I don't see how having a distributed identity system like that works essentially like PGP. You know, that everybody accepts as your digital signature.
Yeah. I mean, you know, like when when there's a self-destruct thing in a science fiction series, generally speaking, two people have to sort of sign off on it.
Mm-hmm.
And they sort of have to have a phrase or something like that, or a password within their own voice print.
Yeah.
Which is unique to them, and they never utter it again. You know, like, sort of like, so it would be like, you know, authorized destruction, Zeta, Gamma, Omega. Or, you know, that sort of thing. You know, where you got to say, you know, a line of poetry or something like that to trigger something truly cataclysmic.
Yeah.
You know, and if that was your voice signature, and you could change it for each different organization, then it would be much harder to forge. I mean, we're not talking about somebody had their signature forged, but hundreds of thousands of people had their signatures in inverted commas forged.
And there's this is why...
that Wells Fargo wrote that person's name down. You know, that it's clearly not their signature. Yeah. And that just shows you how pointless an actual ink signature is.
Yeah, this is why I think if it's a one-time, each signature is a one-time deal that only works on that particular contract. That's why I think
So the company can't use it to create it again.
They can't say,
"Oh, here's another one." That person had to say into
a
microphone, "Wells Fargo, my spare account, blah de blah de blah. My pet dog's name is Rover."
Well, I'm thinking less of...
And then they have to produce that sort of, you know, a sort of like a series of different identifiers to show that you did sign it.
I'm not thinking so much the voice print thing, but just in general, if each time you make you sign it, it has like a one time code embedded into it that says that this signature is only valid for this specific document, but it does mean that it does identify this person as having signed it. If you've got that,
that's what people used to use notaries for.
Yeah.
You know,
that said, I have agreed to this, and I've got my lawyer to double check this.
Yeah, and what happens is the notary would have a crimping tool and would crimp or stamp the document over the top of the signatures.
Yeah.
Which meant that you couldn't then add a signature after it had been stamped. And the notary had their own particular seal, and it would be stamped over the top of the signatures that have been done, so that nothing else could be added on afterwards. I mean, in olden days, in proper olden days, a contract would be two parts of paper, one with the one person's contract on and one with the other person's contract on, and then they'd be torn in half, and half would be added on. So in a court of law, you could present the two bits of paper, and if they matched up at the edges, then that was a valid contract. You'd signed both copies.
I was just thinking of something there. You just gave that notary idea gave me a really good that notary thing gave me a really good idea. So maybe, right? Maybe as part of like this, you have like that wouldn't really work for digital. Actually, I was thinking of something, just making it that everybody had like their own personal notary device, but then I was just thinking that you can't really replicate that into digital too much, unless you go down the route we've already talked about of having a digital signature.
I mean, in China and Asia, quite a lot of people have what they call a chop, which is a little ink stamp.
Oh yeah, I've seen those. They're all individual.
Yeah, completely unique ink stamps to show that you signed a document.
Yeah.
So if somebody says, "Oh, this is your chop," somebody would be able to sort of like say, "Produce your chop," or a signet ring. That's what signet rings used to be for.
Yeah.
You know, to actually put a wax seal onto things.
But anyway, we digress. The problem with things like that, signet rings and chops, is that they can be forged just as easily as the ink signatures can. That's the problem.
Yeah.
That's why the digital signature, to me, seems like the best idea, because if it's a one-time password deal, you can prove that it was generated by the initial key, and you can't copy it, can't use it on anything else. It would protect entirely against forgeries and forging people's signatures.
Okay, so we'll just move along, because
yes,
we're just chewing up time here. Okay, so next news story is American conservative said to Trump, before you give billions to the military, figure out what happens to the $6 trillion we lost in the Middle East. The US lost, as in can't account for, $6 trillion fighting disastrous wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. A fact that Trump was quick to point out during his speech to both houses of Congress, just before announcing that he planned on giving the same government department that literally claims not to know what happened to the money, more billions. As Andrew J. Basovich, a retired Army colonel and conservative historian, writes in the American Conservative, this is nuts. If Trump was serious about fiscal responsibility, he'd be announcing an inquiry into the misjudgments and failures that have saddled future generations with a $6 trillion bill, not more war. Where precisely did all that money go? Republicans and Democrats alike profess to find the question without interest or merit. Most of the trillions have long since sunk into the arid wastes of Iraq and Afghanistan. Remarkably, neither of these two places have even qualified for a mention in Trump's hour-long oration. Instead, the president used the occasion to urge Congress to give the Pentagon more money. Still, lots more. Trump is calling for one of the largest increases in national defense spending in American history, as if he attributing the disappointing results of our recent wars, they mean this is written in America, it's from Boing Boing, to fiscal, and I hate this word, niggardliness. Questionable.
Very questionable.
I am directly quoting there, it's not a word I'd ever use. Anyway, for US military leaders, for the national security apparatus as a whole, for defense contractors, and for Congress itself, Trump was the bearer of good news. As commander-in-chief, he will observe agreement forged by his immediate predecessors. When it comes to war and basic US national security policy, there will be no accountability and no awkward questions. I think $6 trillion is close to the amount of the American trade deficit, isn't it?
I think it's around those lines. Yeah.
$6 trillion to lose.
That's a lot of money.
just like, oh, we don't know where it is. What do you mean you don't know?
Yeah.
I mean, I'll tell you what, if I was at my job and I didn't know where £10 was,
they'd come down on you like a house of bricks.
They'd really freak out. I bet if you were a soldier and you'd sort of like lost, I mean, you know, a single round of ammunition, you'd be filling in forms from here to Sunday.
Oh, yeah. No. The individual soldiers would be up the wazoo if they didn't know where things were. But, I mean, you know, the higher up it gets, the less people want to challenge mistakes.
So the most,
this has always been the case,
money, American dollars wise, you can fit into a suitcase is about $1 million in $100 bills. Okay, that's 10,000 $100 bills is $1 million.
Yep.
And that would be packed tight into a fairly large suitcase. It's quite physically hard to move. So 6 trillion is what? 1,000? Isn't that $1 million? No, it's. Yeah, it's $1 million, isn't it?
I think so, yeah.
So that's six million suitcases full of $100 bills.
Scary. It really is. That's I can't believe that's how much.
So that's the kind of you could have given is. So that's 6 million.
So
that's 1/50. What's 1/50 of $1 million? $20,000.
Well, here's an interesting thing, right?
Yeah. So you could have given everybody in America, like everybody in America, $20,000. Like every man, woman, and child.
Right. Bernie Sanders.
Yeah.
Has on record wanted, or one of the things he wanted to do when if he became president, was he wanted to make higher education or education free for everyone.
Mm.
Do you know how much that would have cost a year?
How much?
$75 billion.
Wow.
And the US military, yeah, $75 billion, right? Giving everyone free healthcare would have been around that same sort of price as well. Right,
that's 150.
Maybe a bit more. 150. Yeah. So, but even then, that's
136
a magnitude
of
order.
Trillion. Yeah.
Yeah, I know, right? It's
136. So like 2% of what the American military have just lost, like misplaced, as in
yeah, could have.
Like it's not like they've not counted a bunch of tanks. And we're talking, you know, 6 aircraft carriers?
Probably.
With full complement of planes?
Probably, yeah. Most likely.
Like, just gone? We don't know. We're not sure. We've looked down the back of the sofa. It ain't there.
Mm-hmm.
6 trillion. I mean, some people should be going to prison for that shit.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, that's... I mean, denying the US military $6 trillion worth of ordnance. Isn't that treason?
Probably. You know, I'd do if I was... I mean, I'm not, obviously, and, you know, America would probably be in a better place if I was, because I'm not Trump. But, you know, if I was there, I'd be, like, asking, why do you want us to give us more money to the US military? Shouldn't we now be saying... You don't get any more money.
Until you come up with a credible reason why you haven't got $6 trillion.
Yeah, exactly. Well, let's give us a reason, then we'll think about it. Want to know where all this money went? You can't just have more money.
Yeah.
Can't just say, oh, I lost it, and then that's it. No. Want a good reason.
Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, if you started a fire, you know, one of the last remaining treasonous acts you can do is start a fire in Her Majesty's dockyards.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's an executable offence, but it is high treason. I mean, that is, mm-hmm. you know, to basically weaken the American military to that degree, because that is taking, you know, if you've spent that money, that's taxpayers' money. That's a lot of taxpayers' money.
That's a lot of taxpayers' money,
yeah. A lot of money. To deny, you might as well have, you know, sort of just blown up an airfield, or, you know, that is treason. In a way.
Mm-hmm.
And in America, that's still high treason, still carries the death penalty. That someone, you know, I'm not saying I'd recommend the death penalty, but under their own laws, wouldn't that be treasonous?
I think
all the things you could have done that would have been good for America, like you said, free higher education, free healthcare. You know, it just doesn't even begin. And Trump's wanting to up the amount of money that the American military get.
I wouldn't say it's not only legally treasonous, probably, but I would say it's ethically treasonous.
Mm.
It's, I've lost this much money, yeah, and I want to give more money to it, but all that money could have been spent on improving the lives of every single American citizen. It's such a waste of money. It really is. I can't believe it. I can't. I'm flummoxed by this.
Yeah. It's just amazing. It's just an amazing, amazing amount of money. I mean, I can't even visualize it. I mean, it's...
Yeah.
You know, it's... Yeah. It's... I'm just trying to think of that many suitcases piled up in an aircraft hangar. Mm-hmm. Full of $100 bills. Just being set fire to, which is what they've done. They can't account for it. I mean, and they've got some pretty creative accounting.
Yeah,
you know, they do some pretty amazing things. I mean, they do things like buy stuff en masse that's not the best thing for the job and more expensive.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even on stupid things like, you know, when they decide a new caliber of ammunition. Instead of going to a gun manufacturer and saying, like, you know, I want a really good gun that uses this ammunition because we've got fucking billions of rounds stockpiled.
Yeah.
They'll buy a completely new weapon and junk all the ammunition. And that in itself is kind of treasonous. If you've got that much serviceable ammunition lying around, unless you've developed a smart gun or some shit like that, there's no reason to get rid of it.
No.
You know. They already hamper their, you know, militaries around the world already hamper themselves by going for very tiny rounds.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, that basically puts soldiers' lives in danger. Like a shitty round, you know, an underpowered round means that you can't take someone out at distance, which means you've got to close with the enemy, which increases casualties.
Well, the interesting thing about that is that the 5.56 standard for ammunition was really designed for a different style of warfare that we have nowadays. It was designed for the World War II era, essentially.
So it's how you could carry hundreds and hundreds of rounds of ammunition.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, it was. It was designed for, well, post-World War II, not exactly as a direct result of World War II, because, I mean, you had 7.62, which was the direct result of World War II, sorry. But 5.56 was sort of like, it was in that between period, between World War II and Vietnam. And they decided they wanted to reduce the amount of collateral damage. This is NATO, I should say. NATO wanted to reduce the amount of collateral damage. They didn't want to kill people. They wanted to wound people. They wanted to wound combatants rather than kill them outright. And this was obviously a time when, you know, warfare wasn't as extreme as it is now. So now what you've got is people that you do actually want to kill outright, because warfare has changed from what it was in the Second World War and the Korean War to being a lot more based on guerrilla tactics.
Yeah, it's a lot more asymmetric now.
Yeah, which is where you need...
Which means that if you've got a 5.56 thing and you're fairly sure that the bad guy 200 meters away is wearing an explosive vest.
Yeah.
You want him, you know, you want him to have two qualities. You want him to be dead and far away.
Yeah.
You know, like Father Ted. These are small, those are far away. You know, bad guy needs to be dead and far from me. Not wounded, still making his way towards me. Not wounded, still driving the truck in my general direction. Fucking dead.
Yeah.
You know, that infantryman needs to be able to take out the guy at, or possibly his vehicle at distance.
Yeah, that's why they pressed the that's why the M14 got repressed back into service in the US military with a body upgrade, of course, but it got pulled back in as a marksman rifle because, you know, they needed the stopping power of the 7.62.
Yeah.
And then they didn't have it with the M16. And
that's why the Coldstream Guards wouldn't take SA-80s to the Falklands.
Yeah.
They took SLRs.
They wanted SLRs, yeah.
I need to put a hole in someone from far away.
Yeah.
Everybody would like to go home. You know, or at least everybody on your side. But yeah, it's 6 trillion. That's just... That's
a massive amount. Fucking hell.
Okay, and your news story's up next.
Yeah, wow, this one. This one's a doozy. So this is from The Guardian. How US billionaire helped back Brexit. Robert Mercer, who bankrolled Donald Trump, played a key role with, quote, sinister, end quote, advice on using Facebook data. The US billionaire who helped bankroll Donald Trump's campaign for the presidency has played a key role in the campaign for Britain to leave the EU, the Observer has learned. It emerged that Robert Mercer, hedge fund billionaire who helped finance Trump, and was revealed this weekend as one of the owners of right-wing Breitbart News Network, is a longtime friend of Nigel Farage. He directed his data analytics firm to provide expert advice to the Leave campaign on how to swing voters via Facebook, a donation of services that was not declared to the Electoral Commission. Cambridge Analytica, an offshoot of the British company SAL Group, which has 25 years' experience in military disinformation campaigns and, quote, election management, end quote, claims to use cutting-edge technology to build intimate psychometric profiles of voters to find and target their emotional triggers. Trump's team paid the firm more than $6 million to target swing voters, and it has now emerged that Mercer also introduced the firm, in which he has a major stake, to Farage. The communications director of Leave.eu, Andy Wigmore, told The Observer that the long-standing friendship between Farage and Mercer led Mercer to offer his help for free to the Brexit campaign because of their shared goals. He said that he introduced Farage and the Leave.eu to Cambridge Analytica. They were happy to help because Nigel Farage is a good friend of Mercer. What they're trying to do in the EU... The strategy involved harvesting data from people's Facebook and other social media profiles and then using machine learning to spread through their networks. Even the guy who was in charge of it said, he says Wigmore admitted the technology and the level of information it gathered from people was, quote, creepy. He said the campaign used this information combined with artificial intelligence to decide who to target with highly individualized advertisements and had built a database of more than 1 million people based on advice of Cambridge Analytica supplied. So essentially what they've done is that Cambridge Analytica have gone through everyone's social media profiles, these million people, and tried to find the most reactionary ways of getting them to vote Leave.
Yeah.
And then targeting advertising at them to promote this.
Yeah.
So it's something that, this is why advertising is such a problem on places like Facebook and Twitter, etc. Because all it needs is for someone to just throw money at them and they'll do this sort of thing. So these people have just been happily, merrily browsing. These people who were most likely centric, you know, they probably would have voted Leave or Remain, whichever. You know, it probably would have been up in the air a little bit. They were on the fence about it for good reasons. And then through this disgusting display of contempt to individuals, people have had advertisements sent to them which have said, essentially been racist, and not racist, I'll correct myself, essentially have drummed up fear in the EU. And have said, and I can only imagine what they've said, but they'll have said all sorts of things to say that immigration is bad and Britain's better off outside the EU. And there's a lot said recently about people being in bubbles. They don't go outside their comfort zone. But what happens when, and I disagree with this, I don't think that bubbles and comfort zones exist for the most part. The only times when these do exist are when people squirrel away in little online communities which exist within themselves, like 4chan, for example.
Well, I think, you know, if you think about it, I once talked about the tsunami of stupidity. That, you know, if you're a bright person, you hang around with bright people, you work at a fairly intelligent job with other bright people, you know, all your social interactions are going to be with people usually of the same sort of political leanings as yourself. And that is in its own way a bubble. So when you are confronted, I mean, I bet you're amazed that, you know, we voted to leave the EU because nobody you knew.
Well, yeah.
You know, apart from a few family members, people that you didn't choose to have in your social circle, would have possibly voted to leave the EU. But leave we did, because all, you know, unbeknownst to us, outside of those bubbles that we put ourselves in socially, people were in their own bubbles, in huge numbers, sort of going, oh yes, if we vote, we can stop people that aren't like us coming to this country.
Well, yeah, okay. I meant was more that... this is companies and political groups injecting lies into these bubbles on social media.
Yeah, because people think that everything that they're told through a computer screen is the truth.
And we're going to get onto this. We'll get onto this later.
Yeah,
this
is people believe what they're told. You've got your YouTube subscriptions. You've got your YouTube preferences that come. This is more the problem with algorithms. Would you like to watch more of this? I mean, even Netflix will steer you towards, you know, things that are similar to what you've already watched.
It is. This is a problem with algorithms. I think when I say I have a problem with bubbles, and it's not, I have a problem with social bubbles where the ones that people create themselves, because everybody does that. That's natural, to only want to talk to people that you have shared opinions with.
Yeah,
in the majority of cases, and that's what we do in real life. We hang around with people we want to hang around with. If you're having a birthday party, that's just an idea put from my head. You don't invite everyone in the world.
No,
you invite your friends.
And you don't, you know, just for a bit of spice, invite your local friendly fascist to your dinner party.
Exactly. You don't
invite
do that.
People
that's
that are
going to
get along with each other. I mean, people put themselves in these bubbles, these echo chambers, and it's sometimes you need to sort of hear about things that you don't agree with.
Well, that and this is why I prefer the term bubble rather than echo chamber. I think echo chamber is something different.
Echo chamber is the more extreme thing, where you're only talking to people that you absolutely certain share exactly your points of view.
Exactly. Whereas a bubble, I would say, is more of just your little... It's. I would say the bubble is the amount of... the scope of people and things that you can think about on a sort of simple level. Essentially, what would have been the bubble, your personal bubble, going back maybe 100 years, would have been the village you lived in.
Yeah.
It would be that. It would just be that village. And the things that you would know about intimately, the people in that village, the things going on in that village. And anything that happened far away, you maybe read the newspaper, that sort of thing. But it would be things far away from you, and you wouldn't really have that much.
They've sent out lots of people to whisper in the ears of influential people in the village.
Yes, that's what's happened.
And tell
essentially
them outright lies. I mean, there wasn't a single fact that bears up any kind of scrutiny in the Leave campaign.
Yeah. And this is essentially, this is the really disgusting part, is that they've essentially, this is a propaganda campaign that's been waged.
Yeah.
You know.
I mean, how many forms do you fill in that says, do you have a social media presence? What's your Facebook name? It's like, I never put anything in that. One of the advantages of being as old as I am is that I can be all curmudgeonly and say, I don't use the bloody thing.
Yeah.
But that's the last thing I'd ever put on any application for anything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what's your social media? Fuck off.
I'd never give anyone my social media details unless it was a person I trusted.
I don't really use Facebook.
No, because, I don't use it either. I've got...
You know, years and years ago, somebody just said to me, if you're not paying for it, you're the product.
Yeah.
And you are the value that Facebook has, if you're a Facebook user. Your Facebook account and all the Facebook accounts that it's linked to are then open to Facebook to exploit if they should choose, or someone else to exploit Facebook if they give them enough money.
Yeah.
And Snapchat and even Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
Every time you give out your Twitter name, it generates a whole thing.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, sort of like, you know, if you're not paying for it, then you're the product. And this is where paying for something, if you pay for something and someone exploits that data that you give them, then that's illegal. If someone's providing you a service on condition that they can exploit the data you put onto Facebook or Snapchat or anything like that, then you've got no legal leg to stand on. You can't make a complaint because you're getting this service for nothing.
Yeah.
And that's... You know, can you imagine trying to sort of like explain that as a moral problem to someone like Mark Zuckerberg? You couldn't. He wouldn't understand what you're talking about.
No, he wouldn't.
He wouldn't understand why that was a bad thing.
Yeah. But yeah, going back to the algorithms really quickly, this is the main issue, and I agree with you on this. It's the algorithms that are the problem. Because we're going back to this... you've got your personal bubble, and that's okay. You're okay to have that. That's natural. But when you have algorithms that say that are designed to show you only stuff related to what you have already seen, you suddenly start getting things that are recommended to you that are reinforced. Most of the times, especially if you're looking for stuff that's... You're talking about things that... But criticism... They'll show things that reinforce them because of how popular they are.
Yeah.
You know, it's not based on any particular merit. So I'm put in mind of Douglas Adams' Hyperland, where the agent in it looks for actually relevant things that you might want to look at afterwards. Mm. YouTube's recommendation system does not work like that. The similarities it looks for are skin deep. And
yeah,
it recommends
I've
you the most popular ones.
A lot of very misogynistic videos are offered up. to me, yeah, because I research into sort of things like feminism. But 90% of what comes up is anti, sort of like men's rights activist stuff.
Yeah, so
very annoying.
So you, if you watch like any video about how good a thing is, and we'll use feminism for this example, you know, what is feminism? And you find a really nice video about explaining what feminism is exactly to the point. The remaining of your recommendations will be really terrible things from, you know, from really terrible people.
Yeah.
Like Thunderfoot, for example, who is a despicable human being. And we'll have Recommedia at the end, which will explain that.
Yeah. So, we'll wrap it up there, because we've got to the end of just over an hour. Mm. And our discussion is more on sort of like the ethics of putting out media and stuff, I guess.
Yeah.
Or the ethics of criticism.
Mm.
So, we're going to play some music again, as usual. I mean, I do intend to get much more organised with this and start cataloguing bits of music and things. But yeah, some music will play now, and then we'll come back with our discussion.
Yep.
My dream kills.
So we're back.
Yeah, we're back. The music.
Go and check out Shameless Promotions. They got some good stuff.
Yeah. Good stuff, Shameless.
So yeah, we're going to talk about I don't know what, just not taking things at face value on the internet.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which you shouldn't anyway, but you know, it's a bit like doing all the research from Wikipedia. It's not a good idea.
Yeah. I mean, I'm going to give an anecdote first of all, because this is going to lead into what we're talking about.
Sure.
And also about some of our recommedia as well. Mm. So, a few years ago, I can't remember exactly when I considered myself an atheist, when I use that term a lot. Mm. And I still kind of do consider myself an atheist, but I don't associate with that anymore. Mainly because of what the atheist community online is kind of like. When I was, you did use that term quite often, I was, I would watch YouTube videos criticizing religion. Especially, and I got pulled onto the YouTuber Thunderfoot. And I started watching his videos about religion, his criticisms of them, thinking, yeah, these are pretty standard. And also his videos about science, because he's a scientist, he's got a PhD, he's co-written many scientific newspapers, he works for a research department at a university, I believe. You know, he's essentially what would be called a well-respected scientist.
Yeah.
And he started criticising, and this actually, I think this was actually before Gamergate. This was before Gamergate. He was commenting on a feminist called Anita Sarkeesian. And he was criticising her for the things she was talking about. And I took these at face value, because I believed that he was telling the truth, because he was a scientist. You know, I thought, yeah, this guy's a scientist, why would he lie? And I believed this for a good maybe 6 to 10 months, and I was thinking to myself, yeah, no, I agree with these things. I would consider myself a men's rights activist, and this was during this point. And there were other people like the Amazing Atheist as well. I'd watch his videos, and it was the same thing. You know, I got there for the criticism of religion, and then it turned into watching the stuff for the men's rights activist stuff.
And did you ever watch Arch Warhammer?
No, not I didn't watch that one, no.
Well, that's kind of weird as an example of it.
Yeah. And I was essentially hoodwinked. These people had brought me in with one thing and were telling me things about another, which I found out later on to be out-and-out lies. And the only reason I found out these were out-and-out lies was I started watching a video... I started watching the YouTuber Varmint Coyote, who was criticizing these people. And he shared a video that was about explaining what feminism actually is in layman terms, and he explained how feminism started, what feminism represents, and what the concept of privilege in feminist theory actually means. And that was a light bulb moment. You know, I was just taken aback, and I had to spend like a couple of hours just like reassessing everything. And then I realized that I'd been lied to by people like Thunderfoot and the Amazing Atheist. Because they were taking things... The crux of it is, these people were taking things massively out of context to reinforce or prove, and I use that in quotes, their own ideologies. They were lying to get their point across, essentially. And I think from the Amazing Atheist, that's what I've come to expect from him. But from Thunderfoot, I think that's massively unethical for him to be lying and demonstrably lying, demonstrably taking things out of context. And if you want proof of that demonstrability, one of our Recommedia links will absolutely point to that, to show how Thunderfoot demonstrably takes feminists out of context to prove his own agenda.
Well, I mean, I think it's especially damaging when you've got the hue and cry attitude of a lot of people on the internet. You know, these people, you know, people will watch a video by someone that they consider a respected source. Whether that's here is Leafy, or Thunderfoot, people will react to what's said, go over to the person's channel of the video that they're criticizing, and put all sorts of like really terrible, you know, horrible comments on.
Yeah,
and it's backfired on Leafy is here a couple of times.
Yeah,
when he's sort of gone, oh god, oh god, this guy's a total retard, and it turns out the guy, the poor sod's got, you know, is autistic, and is getting death threats from, you know, the fans of people that watch these videos, but then don't watch the whole of the rest of the video, the whole of the video that's being commented on.
No,
to see if it's this out of context or not. You know, they sort of like they see a video saying, and this person then said this.
Yeah,
you know, what if, what, you know, sort of like, what if, you know, if you think about all the things that you say in a given day and how many of those things, if you took one sentence out of context, how different the, you know, your opinion of that person would be. You know, if you said something, if you were parodying someone, say like Donald Trump, if I said, you know, and then he said, we're going to build a wall, and that's just great. And you can imagine somebody go, and he said, they're going to build a wall, and that's just great. And you took it completely out of context, rather than as a sarcastic aside. Somebody genuinely believes that I think Trump should build a wall between the US and Mexico.
Yeah.
I mean, it can be done to you every single day. Somebody could literally write down what you said, extract that, and make you look like a completely different person. And that's what these people are doing.
Yeah, that's exactly what they do.
I mean, and I'd have to say, in the case of Anita Sarkeesian, she does sort of go, now look, it's very easy to say, and I've seen her do it, it's very easy to say all white people and all cisgender people are racist and transphobic. And have that misconstrued into her saying all white people are, you know, rather than saying there's a build up to something to say, but that's not necessarily true, and you've got to understand that everybody's an individual. So well, just chop out all these caveats and things.
Yeah, she does actually say that. You know, she does say this is what, you know, this that has been proven again in that the Recommedia we're going to link to.
Yeah, I mean, on that particular one about Anita Sarkeesian, where they've just taken her wildly out of context several times when she's trying to say you need to take a balanced view, and they've made her come across as a rabid feminist.
Yeah, I say, going back to that, after I realised what feminism actually was, I went back and watched Anita Sarkeesian's videos, because I hadn't before.
Yeah.
You know, why did I need to?
Was like, you know, it would be nice if, you know, games manufacturers could write games that didn't immediately try and body shame people or over sexualize characters in video games. That would be a good place to start.
Exactly. You
know, how about a more diverse thing? I mean, there was one where she's talking about Overwatch, and Blizzard have actually taken note of this and gone, oh, you're actually right. You know, let's have a look at our demographic. Oh, our demographic is more or less everybody that plays games. Let's have a look at what makes up that demographic. Oh, it's half women. So, you know, let's have some different, you know, let's have some people of color. Let's have some different diverse body shapes. And they did that. And she was doing a video that basically said, thank God, so, you know, somebody's actually listened and gone, yes, we'll put some diversity in.
And they took that makes a difference to our
sales. And then they sort of said, oh, but she pointed out that these people were all sort of like, you know, sort of sexually attractive. And then they didn't include the bit, but there are also people of different body shapes and different sort of like, you know, apparent sort of gender choices, so that you're not going to feel marginalized.
Yeah.
You know, she was basically saying Blizzard did a good thing. We could do with more of it. That's great. Fantastic. Please keep it up. But they made it sound like she was whining about, you know, all these other characters, and she wasn't. She was just sort of saying, look, you know, we're staying with some of the tropes, but on the other hand, you know, we're moving away from them. You can see there is movement.
Yeah, you know? I mean, I don't this is just as a caveat, I don't agree with everything Anita Sarkeesian says. I agree with a bit of it, but not everything. Because there's always little bits you don't agree with people. But to take someone out of context like that and use it to further your own agenda is just absolutely disgusting and terrible, and it needs to stop. We need to be... But we can't stop them unless we call them out. And which is why it's so important to check to check sources.
Yeah.
And as soon as you find out that someone is not credible, not give them the time of day anymore.
Mm.
This is why I don't give any time. I mean, I've seen people say, oh, I like to listen to both sides to keep up information on them. And it's like, that's fine if you're actively critiquing them. But if people don't want to be actively critiquing people they disagree with, then there's no problem in saying, once you have discovered that you can't trust a person, then don't bother with them anymore. Don't give them the time of day. Don't listen to them.
Yeah.
That's why I don't watch any of Thunderfoot's videos anymore. I don't watch any of Sargon of Akkad's. I will never watch any of Sargon of Akkad's. We don't have anything to do with Stefan Molyneux anymore.
No, I mean, the Stefan Molyneux one was very, very interesting because it's only if you look at the latest video, say, by Stefan Molyneux, and then you go back and listen to the earlier ones, that you realise that not only has this person been a bit disingenuous and taken people out of context deliberately to further their agenda, but they were sowing the seeds of it years before.
Yeah.
In the language that they were using, they were slowly building up to this whole sort of, you know, if you listen to early Stefan Molyneux stuff, I mean, I'm only mentioning him because I listen to an awful lot of his stuff. It is like the frog in the boiling water.
Mm.
You know, do you believe that people should be accepted on their own merits? Well, yes. You know, and then it's sort of like, do you believe that some people are better at some things than others, just naturally? And then the answer is yes. And then it goes, if you've agreed with these first two things, then why don't you agree that men should be in charge of the heads of household and blah blah blah? And then it goes down a whole fucking road, assuming that you're complicit because you said yes to a couple of sort of very, very broad points. And the early Stefan Molyneux stuff is extremely broad.
That's how they get you.
And then it comes down to, you know, it's a bit like religion in the sense that it goes, do you believe everybody should be nice to each other? Well, yes. Then you're a Christian. No.
Yeah.
You know, you've been asked so many questions to which your answer is yes. You get into the habit of sort of agreeing with things because you agreed with the previous statements. And you feel kind of invested because you've agreed with so much of the other stuff. And then that leads to, even when somebody does something utterly fucking heinous, you sort of say, well, I've agreed with them thus far, and I'm sure that sooner or later everything will come back and we'll be back on a thing I can truly agree with. But I'll go along with it, even though this person said or done something reprehensible.
I think what it is you need to be prepared to question even the people you really like. You've also got to be prepared to cut off anything to do with them the second you feel that they've said something that you... Well,
I think people can make errors. I think if somebody said sort of like...
Yeah, that's what I was just about to say.
In the last video, I said this, and I've had time to think about it, and I don't agree with it anymore. If you can retract it...
Yeah. What I was just going to clarify there, I think I think you should be prepared to cut yourself off from a person if you see them as not being able to change. And by that, what you just said there, where they say something heinous, or they do something heinous, and they don't make any effort to change. They don't see themselves as having done anything wrong. That's when you should be like, yeah, no, I'm prepared. I think it's about time that I cut my ties with this person. I did that with JonTron. You know, I used to really enjoy JonTron's comedy, and I thought he was always a bit at the edge sometimes, a bit close to the edge. I don't really agree with what he just said there, but I'll give him another chance. And then after his most recent thing where he was just like, he was massively conflating what feminist theory privilege actually means into being stuff like making really flippant remarks like is he made a remark that said, if you can wear a hijab and buy a Big Mac from McDonald's, that means that racism doesn't exist.
Wow.
And it's just like, that's completely conflating and misinterpreting what the actual situation is. And you obviously don't understand what it is. And this was like the final straw. And I tallied up all the times that I'd felt that way.
Hmm.
And it was like into the double digits. I just hadn't realized it until then. And it was like, no, that's it. I'm done with this person. Done with them entirely. This person's really terrible. Don't want anything to do with them anymore. You must be prepared to... If something sounds suspect, this is the thing. If something sounds suspect, if something sounds disingenuous, if they're not providing context or references, if they're not... The wonderful thing, citation needed needs to come back as a meme.
Yeah.
If they're not providing citations, and that's the big one. If they don't provide citations from, like, legitimate places.
And I think that's where channels... that we, I mean, we were talking about this on... When were you over?
A couple of days ago.
Tuesday.
Yeah.
We were talking about this for people like Garrett.
Yeah.
Who will go away and do all the research and just go, right, okay, you should watch this as well, but, you know, in a nutshell.
Yeah.
You know, there is almost a YouTube industry of critique. Of critique.
Which is good.
You know, if you look at Thunderfoot, his shtick is basically, I will criticize a video. Right, yeah. Criticize a news story, and he will cherry pick all the bits out of it that will prove his personal hell beliefs. And mm-hmm. then you get another person coming along, like H Bomber Guy or Sean and Jen, will come along and basically try and sort of like, you know, actually look into it. You know, it's interesting that you've got this sort of meta critic that, and they're getting quite a lot of views and reads. There are things I worry about people claiming to represent a whole tranche of people putting yep. up videos that are essentially providing straw men for these people.
Yeah, that's the thing, is that a lot of these,
you know, some people out there are some people, you know, say on the subject of feminism, there are some people that really do put up a YouTube video of going hysterical about something that they don't like and claiming it's feminist or racist. I will basically, I may well try and go and find the acne is sexist video.
Yeah.
About a girl that was freaking out about the fact that she had less than clear skin, and, you know, as a feminist, you know, she felt it was a sexism issue that she felt that she should have clearer skin.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is a bit extreme. I don't see how the destruction of the patriarchy would ever stop that girl wishing she had clearer skin.
I think that's... It's...
I don't think any removal of the machinations of the patriarchy could correct that. But she put up a video, and then it was immediately set upon by, you know, all the usual suspects.
I can see where she's coming...
feminism.
Yeah, I can see where she's coming from. And I know why she's saying... Because it is kind of... It's a little bit... It's the bit that says that the part of feminism which is valid that says that that fashion and women's appearances are beholden to men's tastes, which is why, you know, we have over sexualized characters and things, and why, you know, supermodels are considered like the epitome of good looking.
Hmm.
But that also, it's to just put it as that alone is essentially missing, is not, it's missing out a also valid thing that is important to just dispense with ageism and the whole thing, the whole concept of good looks.
Yeah. Well, I don't think we're ever gonna in human future, we're never gonna get away from wanting to be around attractive people.
No, the fashion industry is gonna and exist. That's,
well, not the fashion industry, but just that physical attractiveness.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
In the
because that's
a lot of our visual acuity is basically about spotting a good breeding partner. And even if you're not going to breed with them, even if you are gay, you know, or bisexual, you're going to be attracted to someone that has facial symmetry, that has clear skin, clear eyes, because they look like good breeding stock. And we're just literally, you're never going to get away from that programming.
Yeah. Now, the bit that's feminist is that it's a feminist issue in that she feels she has to do it. That's where it's a feminist issue, essentially. That she feels she has to do it to fit in with society.
Yeah, but that would be, if you could say that if you were male. There's no patriarchal leaning on that. Everybody feels pressure to look good.
Exactly. I mean, well, I'd say there is a patriarchal leaning on it, but that's just disagreeing on that.
Yeah, but I mean, to put up a whole video of that, my point is, like, yes, you can be upset about it, but if you're claiming it's a feminist issue, you'd really better have some stats.
Yeah.
You really need to have some research, though, going that I feel this is sexist is shitty arguing. And when somebody puts up a whole video like that and claims to represent feminists by doing so, you are rather playing into the hands of people that are going to shoot that down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, you know, I think if you're going to make a video that where you claim to speak for a whole bunch of people, you should at least have a chat with some of those people before you put that video up.
Yeah.
Rather than saying, I'm going to do a whole video on how acne is a feminist issue. I'm going to put up a whole video about how my physical appearance affects how I am dealt with and whether I have privilege because I look clear-skinned, well-dressed, educated.
Mm-hmm.
Then yes, go for it.
Yeah.
But to just literally set up a straw man for any MRA to shoot that down in, you know, and then make a lot of people. I mean, because to take the mickey out of that video is it's even my natural inclination.
I think the interesting thing here is also is coming on to something I had a discussion that happened on Twitter that I was involved in a little bit recently, where if you don't make your claims 100%, if you don't give context to your claims when you're making them, they can be taken out of context really easily.
Yeah.
And I think I haven't seen that video, so I can't really comment too much on the acne one. But if I was going to make one like that, I would say, listen, I'm going to talk about this. And then at the end say, I'm kind of feeling that this might be a feminist thing. If you want to, can we have a discussion about that?
Mm.
And that's probably the best way to do it. You know? Going back to the thing that people have got to be wary of. You should always check multiple sources and follow the citations that are given by these people.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you're going to put a point across, like you're not critiquing something, but you've got like, right, I've got a point.
Mm-hmm.
The research really doesn't take all that long.
It really doesn't.
And even to just say, right, okay, so I'm going on this study, and this study, which are all accredited. It took me 5 minutes to do it on, you know, Google. I've had a look into that. If this information that I'm basing my opinion on is wrong, then I'm sorry, but I'm going by what I could see with the available facts.
Yeah. I mean, look at when Sargon used the survey data to try and disprove the 1 in 5 claim. And it turned out that he just hadn't even read the document he was using to disprove it.
Mm.
Because it doesn't disprove it at all.
Yeah, that was an H Bomber Guy video that looked into
was,
that.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was a great video. But yeah, I mean, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, you think, I mean, I think we've got to come back to Thunderfoot. When somebody is a scientist and they've got, you know, I would say a moral obligation to tell the truth, even if it's not the truth you want to hear.
Yeah.
Then that's like a special degree of wrong.
Yeah, no,
it's up there with like a doctor creating a chemical weapon.
It's up there with Andrew Wakefield.
Biological weapon. Yeah.
You know, he's up there with Andrew Wakefield, who completely misrepresented his the date, his findings, to suggest that the measles, mumps, and rubella jab leads to autism. Mm. But his findings don't show that at all. He out and out lied. And I think, oh, it's a special kind of disgusting, unethical charlatan who will take data, actual research data and proven data, scientifically accurate data, and he's a scientist as well, and just completely turn it to fit their own agenda. It's a special kind of despicable.
Well, especially when that can lead to the deaths of children.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's one of those things. We just think, wow, as a scientist, you have a special, like an extra layer of responsibility. You just call science, you call the scientific method into question when you do that.
Yeah.
And it's aggravating enough having to sort of, like, you know, explain what a scientific theory is to people who don't want to believe it, without people fucking around like that.
Exactly. I mean, this is why when people say feminist theory, they're talking about theory in the scientific sense, rather than what the layman would consider a theory.
Yeah.
You know, feminism has been proven to be correct. This is the scary thing. It has been proven to be scientifically correct. There is a patriarchy. It's scientifically proven.
Oh, yes.
No, it's not like... It's not a patriarchy in some sort of mass cabal like the Illuminati. The patriarchy in feminist theory is just the current social status, where men are more enfranchised than cis white men, are more enfranchised than everyone else.
Yeah.
So essentially what it means, it doesn't mean that there's a group of people like pursing their fingers, steepling their fingers together like Mr. Burns going, yes, how can we subjugate the masses today?
No.
It's instead just the default standing.
And people taking advantage of their privilege. I mean, I think privilege is one of those things that takes some careful explaining.
Yes.
And there aren't enough videos out there explaining what privilege is. And there are even fewer good videos. Because I'm sorry, I know people. I'm speaking as a pretty much mostly hetero cis white male here, so I'm kind of like at the top of the privilege tree, really.
Yep.
But telling people that they're evil because they got privilege through an accident of birth is not the way to go about it.
It really isn't. No.
Privilege is like, especially if you're not a wealthy cis white male.
Yeah, you can feel that it's, how am I privileged?
Yeah.
I think there is an element, unfortunately, online of people throwing around as being a bit reactionary.
Mm.
And this is the thing. I mean, I've heard people say, oh, it's there's an offence culture. No, I'd say there's more of a reactionary culture rather than an offence culture. People are a little too quick to react to things.
Now, I'll give you an interesting example of how it can be done wrong.
Yeah.
In that I went to Poly Day last year, which is I think it's a 2-day event where people who are polyamorous meet up with other people who are polyamorous, and they have workshops on how to make relationships work in a non-binary sort of a way.
Okay.
And we were at a book launch the previous evening for a book about polyamory, because they were both in the same city. They were both in London.
Mm-hmm.
And a woman of colour got up and said, Poly Day is, you know, is not very representative of me, being basically black and gay.
Mm-hmm.
And immediately afterwards, somebody said, are you going to Poly Day? And are you giving a talk? Because, you know, you can literally sort of, you know, send them a thing and say, I want to do a workshop on this. And they'll just let you.
Yeah.
And this person wasn't going to Poly Day at all.
Mm-hmm.
And now, you know, there is a bit of me that says, you know, with the creativity that we have today, when you say there aren't enough movies about, you know, that specifically cater to, say, women or homosexual people or people of colour, there is a bit of me that says, off you go. Well volunteered. Go create it. Because you have the tools. You have the tools for free, more or less.
Yeah.
You know, if there's one thing Rangers has taught us, is that if you think that there is a gap in the market or that something doesn't represent you, well, off you toddle. Go make it.
Yeah.
And then fine, if it's not successful or you can't get a platform for it, then you can illustrate quite clearly where that barrier is. But to just say, mm-hmm. Such a thing doesn't exist in the Western world with the technology we have, is kind of like you should be challenging yourself to go make that. And this particular example, and I hate to be slightly muddying the waters, but when this person said, Polyday doesn't cater for me when it's an open platform, my gut reaction was to say, well, give a talk about it.
Yeah.
Explain. And the privilege thing is very similar. It's like, will somebody please make a non-hostile video about privilege?
I'll have to search for one, and we can add to the recommedia for the next episode.
So this sort of challenges us, doesn't it, a little bit?
Yeah.
In that if such a thing does not exist, by spotting it, you have a bit of a responsibility to create it, however badly, mm-hmm. but to at least have had a stab at it.
Yeah.
So I think you and I might need to make a YouTube video in as non-threatening a way as possible about privilege. Yeah. That doesn't say,
we might need to.
You are at fault for falling out of the wrong vagina with the wrong chromosomes.
Yeah. So, well, I think it just as a very basic thing, we could just explain it right now and then we'll see about making a video later. Yeah, because I think we've been talking about it. We haven't really discussed it. So the very basic thing of privilege in feminist theory is that it's not specifically what you get or what you have, it's how people treat you. So it's not something you could even control. It's not something anyone can control. It's just endemic to society. It's how society is. And that's why I don't use it disparaging against anyone, because, and I dislike the meme check your privilege. I really dislike that. And I know every feminist I know dislikes check your privilege because it trivializes the whole thing. Privilege essentially means that you are more likely to get good things and less likely to... No, sorry, you're more likely to have good things happen to you and less likely to have bad things happen to you. And I say things happen to you rather than you being able to get things, because it's not related to money or anything like that. So, as an example, let's just take one specific example. Police stop and searches, right? In the US. It is demonstrable that black males get stopped and searched by police more often than white males.
Yeah.
That is privilege in feminist theory.
So your privilege is, if you're a straight white man and you're wandering along the street at 2 a.m,
you're less likely to be stopped and searched by a police officer. Yeah.
Whereas if you're a black man walking down the street at 2 a.m,
likely to get stopped by a police officer.
Or asked for ID or asked why you're being there are much higher. And that's what they mean, but it doesn't mean that you're immediately wealthy or better off.
No.
Although that can be part of it. And you know, the more extreme examples were in my earlier life, in that there was such a thing as a married man's tax allowance. Because it was expected mm-hmm. that you would be looking after a family. So you got a better tax allowance.
Yeah.
Which turned out to be more than if a man and a woman's tax allowance, if they were living together but not married, would not be as great as a married couple living together, whether they had children or not, because it would be expected that they would have children.
Yeah.
And so society expects things from you. So, it's not legal, but if you're a man, say over 30, and you're in a reasonably good job, you're more likely to get a mortgage than the same person of the same age of a different gender or race.
Yeah, it's.
So it's stuff it like that. It's just the assumptions of society are in your favour.
It all comes down to how society profiles the genders and races. That's all it comes down to. It comes down to how society profiles people, and it's something that we don't need. That's essentially what feminism is trying to get rid of. Feminism is trying to get rid of all profiling.
Yeah.
In fact, actually, that's probably the easiest way of explaining feminism. It wants to get rid of all the profiling that society does. No one should be profiled. Everyone should be on the same sort of level. Yeah. Why profiling should not exist at all. And that's what it wants to get rid of. There's none of this bringing people down. Screw that. No bringing people down. We just want to get everyone on the same level, and no one gets profiled for anything. I mean, not with comes to bank accounts or police or anything like that. Sod it.
Equality of humans does not exist, but equality of opportunity can exist.
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, which is essentially what it is. I mean, I'd far rather call myself an egalitarian. But the problem is, a little over 50% of the planet's population are being repressed because of their gender.
Exactly. That's why.
That's just the long and short of it. So, you know, if you're a man and you sort of say, right, I have, you know, feminist leanings, and I would broadly consider myself to be a feminist, is I'm just going after the biggest persecuted chunk first.
Yeah.
You know, and I would love a world where the word feminist didn't exist. Like, the word feminist would be as redundant as, say, the word suffragette.
Yeah, but it's not.
And there were plenty of male suffragettes.
At the moment. Yeah.
There were lots and lots of male suffragettes. They saw the problem with women not being able to vote, and they saw it up close and personal when they all got drafted and sent off to the First World War.
Yeah.
Because they were men. And basically, if you had to ask the mothers of the country, should we go to war because somebody couldn't be bothered to send a fucking telegram on time, I think the answer would have been a resounding no.
Yeah, that's, and you see, that's it. This is another example of how privilege can be bad for you.
Yeah.
You know?
It's assumed that you're going to go off and fight this fucking war for the freedom of a few rich people.
I mean,
it literally was different members of the Saxe-Coburg royal family falling out with each other.
Yeah.
That's it. I'm not joking. It was literally Queen Victoria's grandson having a war with other grandsons of Queen Victoria. Not physically. Not kind of like man to man, but using, you know, the bodies of the working class people to fight it out. You know, so it's like, you know, this assumption that you know, if your country's in danger, you're off to war. Or if your country's in some sort of perceived danger, which we weren't, off you go, son. You know, there you go. But, you know, if there had been, a referendum on the war and women had been able to vote, that war probably wouldn't happen.
Probably not. But that's the thing, it's like, that's your privilege playing in for you now. You've been drafted.
Yeah.
Because that's what the profile says. The profile says all men go to war.
Yeah, and with the Vietnam War, all heterosexual men are off to war.
Yeah, not sending any of the gays.
Yeah.
It's even worse for you, with your privilege. See, you see why this is an important factor of it?
Yeah.
Because without dealing with it, profiling is going to exist for everyone. And there's no good end to it. Nobody on the profiling spectrum has it good. Okay, there's some people have it much better than others, but everyone still has a bad time for it.
Yeah.
Which is why, you know, we need to get rid of profiling entirely.
Much as we're trying not to do that, I'm a feminist because male privilege hurts me. So, like, I'm a feminist because I think it's complete bollocks. I thought sexism was complete bollocks when I was a kid. I hadn't even begun to think about, you know, how my life was constrained by it.
Well, that's the thing, isn't it? It's like, I'm not a feminist because I'm personally affected. I'm a feminist because it affects everyone. It's more, it's much bigger than me. Immeasurably much bigger than me by a factor of billions.
To me, it's just a
much bigger
thing.
Than me.
In that, if you deny education, say you get a female child of colour that's brilliant at maths, you know, absolutely astounding. But because of her gender and her colour, she's not encouraged to be an engineer or a scientist.
Mm-hmm.
That means I've got to wait many, many more years until a white male person comes up with the same fucking idea.
Yeah.
Not good enough. I want it yesterday. No. I want that shit fixed. And if by having everybody with all around the world with equal opportunities, my planet lasts longer or works better or people are happier, I want it done yesterday.
Yeah.
You know, if you've got a way of making the world better, up and fucking do it. And if I've got to, you know, just, you know, push and make sure that everybody gets a good educational opportunity, you know, it's whatchamacallit? What's it? Informed self-interest.
Mm.
It's just I want things solved. I want the very best people doing the things that they're good at that make the world a better place.
Yeah.
And, you know, half the planet's women. So that's half the ideas not being listened to.
Yeah.
Half the good ideas, half of all the things that will make my life better are being discounted because of the plumbing of the person that thought of them.
Yeah.
That's just scary. Fucking stupid.
Yes.
Yeah. It's really... I was like, okay, so everything's got to take twice as long as it needs to. Maybe longer because people want to hang on to power. Yes. That's bollocks.
Yeah.
No. I don't agree.
And that's
why I'm a feminist. I want a better planet to live on. And one of the ways to do that is, you know, to not, you know, judge people because of where their sex organs are.
Exactly. I think that's also worth highlighting there what you just did. That the what's the majority reason for people discounting feminism?
Because they want to hang on to power. That privilege. And it's like, well, why? Why do you need that implied power over other people? The only person... telling people what to do will not make you happy.
No.
You know...
It won't.
All happiness is internal. It's not down... You know, and as is all unhappiness is internal.
Mm-hmm.
It's about how you react to things that you're told. You just go, no, that's bollocks. That's, you know, I don't like it when people feel a pathological need because of a bit of their lizard brain says, if I am the biggest lizard, I get to mate with all the females.
Yep.
That's, yeah, I think you'll find that's outdated by probably 50 million years. You know, that part of your brain that says I should be in fucking charge is so basic. And it just you know, it's all linked to how many times you get to breed.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't remotely have a bearing on the reality of the situation.
Exactly.
You know, do you want to have 5,000 children? No. Because anybody with one eye and half a brain realizes that having lots and lots of children is not good for the planet.
Exactly.
So this breeding imperative needs to go. You know, as a reason you do things. So you look more attractive to members of the opposite sex with whom you can breed is bollocks.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so subjugating people in order to feel all big, strong and powerful is all that's doing is plugging into that lizard brain and going,
yeah.
Oh yeah, now I can really get, you know. And I think that's why anti-feminists are so angry, because their misogynistic views make them less attractive even though they've got lots of followers.
Yeah.
So they've got this power, but the reason that they sought out the power isn't going to happen. Because, you know, women aren't really going to want to have a lot to do with someone that hates them.
No.
But they've had to build themselves up into a position of hating women in order to get followed by all these adolescent young boys who haven't really figured it out yet.
Yeah.
You know. If you don't, you know, people want to be with people that respect them. If you build a whole platform of this lizard brain, I want to have sex with as many females as possible, by saying you hate women, it's self-defeating. There's no point in acquiring the power to oppress people, because you're not going to be impressing anybody.
Yeah.
You know, you're certainly not going to be impressing people that you want to breed with. it's really weird. It's fucked up, this whole power trip thing. And that's
what it really is.
Most of these people don't believe what they're saying. They're just doing it to get zillions of hits and zillions of followers and subscribers.
Yeah.
I mean, for example, that Milo Yiannopoulos dude.
Milo Yiannopoulos, yeah.
Yeah. He's already admitted that he didn't mean any of it. And this whole sort of like alt-right shit was literally just to wind people up and get famous.
Yep.
But think of, you know, what, you know, it's that whole thing. I did this thing to become famous, but it's not exactly harm-free. If it's going to trigger someone to walk into, you know, a black church and gun down a whole bunch of people because you believe that, you know, Milo Yiannopoulos is right.
Yeah.
And you're going to do something about it. That's not, you know, if you don't, if you genuinely think that it's bullshit and you're just manipulating people like a sociopath, and then something like that happens, you are part in part responsible.
Yeah, I think it's entirely responsible if they're doing stuff like that.
Yeah. So yeah, check your sources. You know, loads of, especially the MRA stuff, nearly always taken out of context.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's this also plays into what we were talking about earlier with the. With the problem with algorithms, because when you see a video, you see something quite critical on YouTube. Let's say you take one of Thunderfoot's videos, you watch one of his videos. In the recommended videos, you don't see a video criticizing that. You see a video reinforcing that.
Yeah.
Well, and that's a problem.
And that's where I think if you include your sources, and you're prepared to be called on it,
mm-hmm.
then that's more responsible.
Much more responsible.
I mean, you get that with Garrett's videos. You know, go and watch yeah. this video. I'm not taking it out of context. This is what's really being said. Or H-Bomber Guy generally includes yeah. the source video links. I think on some of them that they haven't, but that's deliberately because they don't want to give that other person the feeling that lots of other people agree with them.
Mm-hmm.
So the last thing you want is some sort of racist homophobe getting 4 million hits because people watched Garrett's video and then wanted to watch the original source material.
Yeah.
You know, that's a bit of a problem. Or if you do go and check it, yeah, if you do feel the urge to go and watch one of these videos, tick the don't like thing.
Yeah, make sure you give it a thumbs down. That's yeah. I always do that.
Yeah, just do that. I do not agree. Yeah, you know, I wouldn't bother being in the comments because your comment will never get read, or it will, you know.
Just incur the wrath of fanboys.
Well, fuck that. I don't know. It's just like rare, really. Come round. Come round in numbers. Come to my house. We'll sort it out. If you desperately yeah. want to sort it out man to man, then we can do that. But really, I've got no time for someone leaving a shitty comment. I think I've got one dislike on all of my YouTube channel ever.
Mm-hmm.
And it was on the robot arm video.
Wow.
I don't understand how you could not like that video. I make no political point in that. I don't state any opinion. I literally tell you how to build the controller for the Mii Arm, which I think is a brilliant product anyway. Because mm-hmm. I always wanted a robot arm as a kid. I've got no idea. It's sitting in a box now. Now that I got it to work, I've got no idea what to do with it. I really wanted one as a kid. It's a bit like a train set. And I just literally showed you how to make one for £4 and included all the code as a download.
Yeah.
And a schematic. And close-up photographs of where everything was plugged in. I really did make it, like, the cheap... I wrote it for schools.
Mm-hmm.
It was, like, the noblest video I've ever done, you know, with sort of, like, really high ideals. And, like, here, how to make something for, like, next to nothing. There. You can do it for... You know, you can make the controller from nothing if you've got the Mii Arm for £10. Mm-hmm. Here's how. Even the guy that made the Mii Arm liked the video.
That's awesome.
I met him and I said, I did that video, and he said it was a great video. I'm really impressed in person and on the video, and somebody unliked it. I'm not being bitter. I just don't understand. If I'd made some sort of point and said the Mii Arm was crap or, you know, something like that, I could understand someone unliking it. But there's no opinion yeah. in that to not like. It's just a, here is how to make the quickest, dirtiest, cheapest Mii Arm controller so you can do something with it straight away.
Mm-hmm.
Here is the code. If you improve it, let me know, because I'd like to not have to write the better code for it.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's just me. We're going to wrap it up there. I think we should make a video on privilege.
We should do. I think I agree with you there.
Yeah, I think we should do that. So that was our discussion, because time's marching on. I've got to go to work in 10 minutes. So we in the Recommedia, Silicon Cowboys, a movie about the compact computer and the generation of Phoenix BIOS.
Yep.
Which is well worth your time if you're at all into computer history. And Sean and Jen's YouTube channel is just called Sean and Jen on YouTube. And I'll put a link into the Anita Sarkeesian one, which is very interesting.
Oh, that's beautiful.
It's a good video.
Criticism of Thunderfoot.
Yeah. Oh, and if you want to watch some people uselessly surviving the zombie apocalypse, it will make you angry. But Fear the Walking Dead, have you seen that?
Okay. No, I haven't.
It's basically people that are so massively unequipped to deal with anything, trying to deal with a zombie apocalypse. It will make you cross. It's a bit like watching Bear Grylls The Island.
Oh, I'll have to watch that then.
But like a fictional, but with zombies.
Yeah.
Just like, oh, shit, really? I mean, lots of people wandering off without comms and, you know, not making sure that they've got the ability to sort out water and stuff. There are people really fucking up on a grand scale. There's only one sensible person in it. And he's made out to be the bad guy because he's a bit practical.
I think I'll definitely have to check that out.
Okay. Well, thanks again, as ever, for listening, if you've listened this far. Feel free to get in touch at v4v@earthling.net if you've got any recommendations for news stories or anything like that. Go into the IRC channel, have a chat with people there, which is something I haven't done in a little while. I've been busy working. And yeah, all cool. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Good show.
Thanks very much, folks. We'll see you again.
Take care, and we'll now play some outro music, which I also haven't sorted out at the time of recording. We're pushed for time this week. Okay. Mm-hmm. Take care. Farewell.
Bye-bye.
Just take it easy, man.
I'm perfectly calm, dude.
Yeah, waving the fucking gun around?
Calmer than you are.
Will you just take it easy?
Calmer than you are.